we've got the most wonderful lady, Robyn Steward, on with us now. She's an award-winning broadcaster, trainer and musician, just to list a few of her accolades. I'm absolutely delighted to welcome her to the show today. So, Robyn, hello.
Hello.
Hiya, Robyn. Listen, thank you so much for coming on the show today.
Thanks so much for having me, and I'm really glad to be on a show, well, with you as well, but also with Gina, because I know Gina, and yes, she's great.
So yeah, yeah.
It's really lovely.
Great, great. Listen, I'm going to get right to it, Robyn, because we've got like less than a half an hour, and I will just let people know that I know that you're a beautiful musician and that you're going to play something for us maybe towards the end of the show, if that would be okay with you.
I will. Well, great. Why don't I play the show out?
Great. That would be absolutely fabulous. So what I'm going to do so is I'm going to start with our questions, if that's okay. So I suppose the first question for you is, will you just give our listeners a little, a quick overview of your own autism journey, what age you were diagnosed at, what it was like to be a girl growing up with autism and all that?
Yeah, so I'm 31, and so I was born in the mid 80s, and I have 10 disabilities, and that was quite helpful because it got me into the special needs unit within primary school. And then when I moved from the infants to the juniors, so when I was about 8 years old, the teacher sort of took my mum to one side, suggested that maybe I had autism, and my mum had already picked up very early on with things, you know, like social communication things, you know, like eye contact and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
So she kind of thought, you know, that I had autism, and it never bothered her. She was just very focused on giving me communication tools, not necessarily just speech, but other types of communication like Makaton, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And so the teacher, with my mum's consent, referred me to see a psychiatrist, which I guess now would be the Children and Adolescent Mental Health Service. And 3 years later, I got my diagnosis. I don't think it took us 3 years for me to be seen by somebody. I think the wait was, you know, it did take a while. But I think that what took the time was that, you know, Asperger's syndrome, which was what I was diagnosed with, was only added into sort of
the DSM or the ICD, yeah, I suppose, yeah.
The DSM in 1994,
yeah.
Which would have been about when I was referred. So it took a while for people to be tooled up with that. And I'm lucky that perhaps I've got more of a masculine presentation of autism.
Okay.
I think that maybe, so I do think it's really good that we're talking about women and girls more in terms of autism, but I wonder whether we're really talking about a female and masculine, a feminine and masculine presentation of autism. So just as any person can be masculine and feminine,
yeah,
regardless of their actual physical gender, I wonder whether it, you know, because we now talk about, you know, people like Chris Gilberg talk about autism. So
yeah.
I wonder whether it's that I have a more masculine presentation of autism compared to other women and girls, because I'm quite a kind of loud person, and perhaps that's why. Whereas I think that it is harder for women and girls, and also boys and men who are maybe quieter,
yeah,
perhaps a bit more reserved. So I was lucky in that way. So I think I was very lucky to get the diagnosis when I did. It didn't help my schooling at all, because nobody really knew about autism in practical terms. And certainly, you know, again, if you think about the sort of historical context of that, you know, it was around that time when Jim Sinclair and Donna Williams and Wen Lawson were, you know, just sort of starting the self-advocacy movement. And so, you know, people didn't really have access to people like me. And so that certainly, I think that caused a lot of, certainly for me anyway, it didn't help me. So I think it hindered that kind of lack of information, hindered a lot of people.
Yeah.
I think that, you know, just as Gina was saying with the attention program, you know, it's really important that people have that practical hands-on knowledge, as well as also hearing about people's personal experience. I think those two things go hand in hand. I know Gina didn't talk about personal experience, but but they, you know, she talked about the hands-on practical experience. And so I think you need that, and you need the personal experience from people, because I think that once you hear somebody explain it, I mean, particularly when you hear a range of people. So there was a book published by All Angel, which is a very small publishing house, which is publishes all autism books. And there's this book which I think is called Autism Stories. It has an orange cover, and it's six people who've basically written an essay each on an aspect of autism that affects them, you know, their sort of experience. I'm not sure if I'm explaining it well, but that's a great book. So I don't think that having a diagnosis helped me. I went into high school, and then I was bullied, and I had an absolutely miserable time. Primary school had been very good until they tried to mainstream me, and you know, the teachers, they didn't really want a disabled kid like me in their classes, because it meant working differently and thinking differently.
Yeah.
And I think high school was a lot of the same, really. I think that, you know, I was quite traumatised by the experiences I had, which sounds very sort of dramatic, and I certainly don't want it to sound too dramatic, but you know, there has been talk over the last few years, and I do think it's probably true that autistic people can, not all autistic people obviously, but some autistic people can experience PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, and the triggers can be smaller. So we normally associate PTSD with people that have been in war zones and things like that. For autistic people, it does seem that some autistic people can have the symptoms of PTSD, but the triggers can be smaller, so like school bullying and things like that. So I had quite a hard childhood, really.
Okay.
And then when I was in college, so further education, I got kicked out of school and went into college, and I was still getting bullied, but I was introduced to a group of people with Asperger's like me, and all of us said that the two things that we'd like, we were there to sort of try and make things better for people with Asperger's as well as supporting ourselves, was we wanted a safe space where we could, you know, go and be ourselves, and also staff training. And I said I thought it should be us doing the staff training. And so three of us, Ian, Kerry and I, we each sort of took a bit of the training on. So Ian talked about his experience of going into college, and Kerry talked about her experience of special school and how that sort of coloured her, you know, future education experiences.
Yeah.
And I talked about the theories around autism, I read about Theory of Mind, which there's a paper by Simon Baron Cohen, Nuta Frith, and Alan Leslie. Putting yourself in someone else's shoes, understanding why someone else might do something, and if you do such and such a thing, what the consequences might be, that kind of thing. And that's very common for autistic people to have difficulties with that, and I recognise that in myself, and I realised that if I taught the neurotypical people about autistic people, they could teach me about neurotypical people, and then I could change the way I behaved to the bullies, because they were telling some of the teachers were saying, you know, you're bringing the bullying on yourself, and I just didn't have the knowledge to know what response I should give to the bullies, because it wasn't always possible to ignore it, because, you know, and the other thing that, you know, since that, I'm jumping ahead a bit. So then after that, I started doing autism training, and then in my first year of university, I only did 1 year. I mean, I got good grades and everything, but
1 year was enough.
I just ended up in a career of autism, and I didn't want to get in debt. I think if the education had been three, I would have done it.
Yeah.
But I don't come from a very wealthy family, and so they couldn't put me through university. I think by then I'd sort of had enough. But one thing I did do was volunteer with the National Autistic Society.
Yeah.
I volunteered as what was then called a media talker. I now called an ambassador, but it's kind of the same thing. So what basically, when you know, a news program asked if I could, you know, if they could have an autistic person to talk about something, I was within a pool of people who could do that.
Okay.
So I was asked to speak on Channel 4 News with Jon Snow, and I talked about a social skills program called Peers, which is PEERS.
Okay.
And the thing about peers is that it was a research program, but it's now been rolled out and more people can access it. The thing about it is that it's ecologically valid.
Okay.
And all that means is that the things that they're teaching the young people around social skills are the things that actually happen in the real world.
Good.
So if you ask a group of parents, what would you tell your child if someone's calling them a nasty name? Most parents will say either walk away or tell a teacher, or they'll say both. And when you ask them, does that work? They all say no.
Yeah.
When you ask kids, is that what you do? They say no. So what young people actually do when somebody calls them a nasty name is they'll sort of rebuff the bully, but in a way that doesn't, it's like throwing a fire blanket over the bully.
Yeah.
It's not actually throwing a fire blanket, you're not throwing anything. But you say something like, whatever, like something that doesn't give the bully fuel and puts a sort of full stop to the interaction.
Yeah.
Without, if you walk away, the bully will just try harder to bully you. So they're passionate about the idea that autistic people should have knowledge that is ecologically valid.
Yeah.
So that they can, you know, interact with the world. And so I sort of started to... I was already mentoring young people.
Yeah.
And then I started getting paid to mentor people, which really surprised me because I didn't think that I did anything that any of the other mentors on the volunteer program I was on did.
Okay.
Differently. You know, all I did really was listen to the young people because that seemed to be what they needed. I think probably all young people need to be listened to.
Yeah, absolutely.
But I think I just was conscious to find ways of communicating that I was listening to the young person without, you know, jumping in or commenting. Like, I can just sit there and listen to them but let them know that I'm listening, and sometimes that was about what questions I asked, or, you know, so I didn't rely on eye contact or facial expression, which perhaps that's how neurotypical people would interact, but because I was working with autistic people and I am autistic and I knew that thing about theory of mind and that being a problem, I think that I just sort of asked people what they needed and what they wanted, and talked in terms of sort of experimenting with ideas to make that person feel supported, so that it wasn't like, well, I know all the answers because I'm a mentor, because that isn't what it was about.
Yeah.
And then because I'd done the Channel 4 news thing, I got offered to apply for the Charlie Vane Travel Trust Award, which was a thing at Cambridge University.
Yeah.
And I applied. I really didn't think I'd get it, but I'd put down Los Angeles because that's where the research had been done.
Okay.
And they gave me £600 to go to Los Angeles.
I had to ring
the they're called a primary investigator. That just means the person that's overall in charge of a piece of research. And her name was Liz Loggerson, or is Liz Loggerson. So I rang Liz and I said, hello, I'm Robyn. I've never spoken to her before. I'm Robyn and I was on Channel 4 News about your search. And she's like, oh, I know who you are.
Great.
And so she gave me a really structured fortnight visit to LA, seeing all these different programs. And UCLA, of course, is where ABA comes from.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I saw all these different sorts of programs, like right across the spectrum of ways of supporting autistic people, and which I thought was quite incredible, really, and I was so lucky. In 2013, because I was co-chairing the National Autistic Society's Professional Conference, in 2012, I went up to Jessica Kingsley Publishers and said, can I write a book for you?
Yeah.
And they said yes. And then in 2013, my book, The Independent Woman's Handbook for Super Safe Living on the Autistic Spectrum, came out. And then I started doing research, asking autistic people their experiences of things that were important to them, because I heard professionals talking in a way that I didn't think what the professionals were saying was particularly ecologically valid.
Okay.
So that means I didn't think that what the professionals were saying were things that are really happened in real life. So, for example, I heard a professional say that autistic people only like to flap because they've been told not to do it. And that is,
sorry,
like,
no. I actually don't know how to respond to a comment like that is all I'd say.
That's like the opposite of most autistic people. I mean, maybe there are a small minority of autistic people for whom that is true, but I knew that that wasn't a majority. Yeah. And so I decided that it wasn't ecologically valid what he was saying, and I took a gamble on that he hadn't asked 100 autistic people. So I asked 100 autistic people on an online survey and proved him wrong. And
well done. Well done, Robyn. Well done.
50% of people said they enjoyed swimming. 30% of people said sometimes they enjoyed swimming. But 72% of people had been told not to do it.
Yeah.
And people said that the top three reasons for doing it were to reduce anxiety, to calm down, and still overstimulated senses. But then within that, there was a whole range of things. Like people said, you know, they stim when they're happy, when they're excited. You know, like there's lots of different reasons why people stim. Those three just happened to be the top out of it. And there also, amongst the 100 people, there was, I think, 102 unique types of stimming.
Right, right. I must get that paper. I'll actually get you to email me that information. I'd be really interested in reading that, definitely.
Well, so what happened was I started talking about this and being like, well, this isn't proper research, but, you know, this is why I did. And I'd said, you know, on the onset, when I'd done the survey, I'd said to people, look, I'm not going to identify anybody or anything like that, but I do, the reason I'm doing this is because I want to present it as in a presentation, because I want other people to understand stimming better. So people had already, you know, knew that I was going to do this PowerPoint presentation and talk about it. And so I was talking about it, and then Liz Pelicano, another Liz, from the Centre for Research in Autism and Education at University College London, she said, you know, this is really proper research and this is really great. And she, I don't quite know how, but she made me an honorary research associate.
Wow.
And what that meant was I had access to an ethics board. So whenever I did a survey, I could check that it was ethical. So that was a very important step. For the last several years, I've just sort of been doing that. And I'm also on the Artist Development Programme of Heart and Soul, who are an arts organisation. And they believe in the talents and powers of people with learning disabilities and autism.
Fab.
We're doing a project on well-being over the next couple of years.
Oh, great. Great. Do you know what, Robyn? I'm literally blown away by how much you've achieved as such a young person. Is what I'm absolutely blown away. I know that I have all of these questions here for you, and I could just sit and not ask any of them and just listen to you. Like you seem to like you've so much to say and so many valid points to make. If you know what I mean. I suppose one of the things that I would pick up on, if it's okay, is you mentioned that you had a difficult time in school, and I suppose for my listeners, I know that I do have listeners either being bullied or parents of children being bullied or whatever. Is there any kind of advice or strategy or something that worked for you dealing with those times that a parent or a child might help them through that difficult time?
Well, what I wish I'd known when I was at school was they used peers, the social skills training program used to call it Tease the Tees, but they had to change the name because it is because people took that literally. It isn't actually teasing the person doing the teasing.
Okay.
What it means is if someone came up to me and said, Robyn, you're really fat, or Robyn, you're really ugly, I could say whatever and just walk off.
Okay.
And that way I've given the bully something, but they can't actually do anything. If you think about it, if you made a mind map of what you could do with somebody that said whatever, because if I said, oh, well, actually, I don't think I'm fat, then they could go, no, you're really ugly.
You're giving them an opening to say, that's a really good point, actually, that's a really good point. I think maybe if parents or if individuals came up with a couple of different key phrases, even to learn them off, key phrases or key words that might just, that are non-explosive, that are non-reactive, and that gives a bully no power over having something to say back. Maybe even to learn them off just until such time as they become more natural or more fluid? Because I know a lot of the time your instinct, well, I know my instinct, I do tend to stop it, but your immediate instinct is to go, oh my God, I want to go in and I want to kick their behinds or call them a name back, or do you know those? And like, that's not proactive, and that's not giving the young person the skills to deal with it. Whereas I think, I definitely think, the peers program, we'd say, Robyn, is there somewhere online that people can look at that program?
Yeah, well, Liz Loggison actually has written a couple of books. There's one called The Science of Making Friends, and to be honest, I can't remember what the other one is called.
No, that's fine.
The Science of Making Friends.
The Science, and Liz
Loggison.
Yeah, the Science of Making Friends.
I can send you that in an email. So I'll spell it.
Just to let people know, because I think part of the reason for this show is just to equip people, like you've done now, just to equip people with the strategies and the information and knowing how to move forward and trying to support themselves independently as well. Do you know?
Yeah, I think the other thing I would say, and I know that this might be a little bit controversial, but I'll explain why I'm saying it, is when a young person gets to the age where people within their peer group swear sometimes, that actually it's really important that you learn to do that, because my parents taught me to have a very clean mouth and not to swear.
Okay.
And what happened was then I couldn't tell anybody in the age, because young people, when they're in their, you know, sort of mid to late teens, you know, if someone really annoys them, they sort of tell them to F off, and that's, you know, kind of what, that's the age-appropriate thing to do. But what you have to learn with that is the context.
Yeah.
Like, you have to be able to identify the context in which it's okay to do that. But actually, you sound very odd if you know, to other young people. Like, if you're trying to just sort of manage socially, you sound a bit odd if you don't ever swear.
And
especially with, you know, I've got those sort of posh accents, so with my posh accent and me not swearing, and once I called somebody a dancing bean, and that just caused more problems. So sometimes actually you don't have to, I mean, you don't, you know, you can, like, obviously, you know, if you're teaching that skill, you know, it doesn't have to be every other word is a swear word, but just being able to tell people to F off sometimes is quite important.
I think, Robyn, I agree that it is quite controversial, but I know in our house that we have discussed slang words and what they mean and what would be an appropriate context in which to use it, or if somebody says something, that this is what they might mean in that context. If, you know, I do think it's actually really important, because part of the teen years, part of growing up, part of that kind of rite of passage is being able to slag and being able to banter, being able to curse, fair enough, but being able to even read those kind of those slang words that people use. Do you know, I think it's really important actually to make sure that kids are aware of those kind of things in order to be able to fit in, as you say. So I apologise equally if it seems controversial, but I actually think it's a really, really, really valid point that you've just made that nobody has made to date.
Yeah, well, the thing that, and this isn't, I don't think this involves a swear word, but the story that sticks out for me, apart from the laughing bean thing, is I was on a school trip to Belgium, and a kid came up to me and asked me if I was a virgin or not. And I'd have been 13 or 14, and I genuinely didn't know what it meant. And I thought that the right answer would be yes. Then, you know, that caused more bullying.
Yeah.
So it's really important that you do know what young people are talking about, because then you might agree to do something and you might not understand what it is that you're actually agreeing to.
I think you've literally hit the nail on the head, to use that that idiom. Like, you've stated it so clearly there, to let people know, because I do think parents are afraid that they don't want to be equipping their child with negative language or that, and that they might be seen as a bad parent. But there's a balance that can absolutely be struck to make sure that your child isn't further targeted for any kind of by any kind of person that would have those kind of bullying intentions. Do you know?
Yeah, I think a non-inflammatory example would be now a lot of people are getting PPI rebate.
Yeah.
And in the 90s and noughties, people were being sold PPI, and I think most people didn't really understand the ins and outs of PPI, which is why people are getting refunded. So those shoppers who bought into PPI were vulnerable, and they were made vulnerable because they didn't have the information.
Yeah.
So for autistic people, they often don't have the social information that most people typically get. And so that makes them vulnerable. So you're really tooling somebody up and making them less likely to experience abuse.
Yeah. Absolutely. Listen, Robyn, I'm watching the time now. We're starting to run out of time. I have two very quick questions and then I'm going to get you to play out the show, if that's okay. One of the things is just that I want to just to let people know that you did win an Autism Professionals Award in 2015. And I'd love for you to tell me in literally 50 words what it meant to you and why you received it.
Well, I was really quite surprised. What it meant to me was that more people would be aware of. So the reason I won it was because I got raped when I was 20, and I did a lot of work around giving people tools and information to keep themselves safe, and that was one of the research projects that I did. And I think that the award meant that more people would be aware of sexual violence against autistic people. And hopefully that will mean more people have skills to stay safe.
Okay, all I'd say as an answer to that is thank you for sharing is the first thing I'd say. And second of all, wow is the other thing. I won't say anything other than just wow, well done. And the other thing I do want to ask you about very quickly is I know you gave a TED Talk, The Autistic Spectrum from a Person, Not a Textbook, in 2016. Will you tell me, again, a brief synopsis as to what this was about, just to let people know, because I know that I've looked at it on YouTube and it's a fabulous TED Talk. So if you could let people know very quickly what that's about.
Yeah, well, it's a long time ago. I'm not sure if I can 100% remember, but I think what it was about was just explaining what autism means in real terms.
Good.
Rather than just a textbook.
Good. Just literally letting people know what it's like to be living with autism and whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I think what I will say, Robyn, is that I've been looking at your website. I've been looking at all that. You're an amazing, amazing, amazing young lady. You're definitely paving the way to change the face of autism as we know it today in society. I think that what you're doing is absolutely amazing, absolutely fantastic. You're 31. Jeez, if I had a quarter of what you've done at 31, done when I was 31, I'd be very proud of myself. I think well done is all I can say.
Thank you very much.
So guys, that is the absolutely lovely Robyn Steward. I'm so delighted that she came on the show today. I had about 40 questions for her. I asked her probably three, but I think that she shared so much about bullying and everything. I hope that everybody gained some insight as to how to best support your young person if they are going through a difficult time like that. Thank you for listening. I'd like to say thanks again to the lovely Gina Davies and to the lovely Robyn Steward. I'm going to put Robyn back on the air now and she's going to play us out. So Robyn,
I'm here.
You're ready. Listen, thank you so much and start away whenever you're ready. Thanks a million, Robyn.
Thank you.
Now, guys, thanks a million for tuning in, and don't forget to tune in again next time.